I'm not the kind of doctor most people want to see. I'm not your beloved pediatrician who can give your child a shot without a single tear. I'm not even a dermatologist who you love because they clear up your skin. No, I'm a kidney doctor. Whenever people find out what I do, they usually go, "You know, my friend's neighbor is on dialysis. They look exhausted. Terrible. Right. When a patient sees me for the first time, they are often terrified. They have the data, the numbers, all of the test results at hand. And it usually goes something like this. This says I have 45% kidney function. Am I going to need dialysis? I tell them, think of your kidneys like a gas tank, except you only get to fill it up once and it should last you the whole way through. But sometimes something happens to the kidneys and your function goes down. As long as there's more than 15%, there is gas in the tank. But once it hits 15, the light comes on. You could still drive a little, but it's going to stop in the middle of the road. That's when dialysis comes in. As soon as they hear this story, I see a light bulb in their eyes. For some, months of worry roll off their shoulders. Because before they came in, they had genuinely thought they needed dialysis. And others, they will lean forward, finally ready to engage. They go, "All right, I get it. Tell me what I need to do. I don't want to run out of gas." It was a story I found myself telling all the time. And the more I told this story, the more I realized that this was what I had to do as a doctor and a researcher. To find the voice of data and let it be heard. We live in a time where society says, data needs to speak for itself. But it doesn't really work like that. No matter how significant the data might be, without a story, no one is going to be able to hear what it has to say. And without a story, no one will move or make changes in their lives. 3 years ago, I completed my master's degree after having done all the necessary research. And yet, I had zero publications. I was embarrassed, and I had trouble finding a research position. Who wants to hire a researcher who can't publish their science? Then, I found a secret to publishing research papers. Nobody wants more data. People want a solution to their problems. I had tables and tables of data, but unless I was able to pull the story out of the numbers, these stacks of information will only go to one special place, the rejection pile. But when a researcher is able to use data storytelling to solve a problem, only then can science move forward. Data does not only come in tabular forms or in Excel sheets. Data comes in many forms. Text, numbers, images, scenes, and they're everywhere around us. We live in a digital era where there is information overload and message saturation. We have TV, podcasts, social media. In a world where cat videos get more attention than more pressing issues, how can we even break through the noise? Don't get me wrong, I love cats. But I think we can all agree that they're not the solution to every problem. Then I went viral on Twitter. I was sharing a Twitter thread about my experience as a new mother during medical residency training. I was a star intern. But when I came back after maternity leave 4 weeks later, people were asking, "What happened to Gia?" I disappeared in the middle of the rounds. I did not know my patients well, and I completed my notes late. What was I doing instead? I was sneaking out 4 times a day to pump. I was hiding in a corner, calling my mom to check how my baby was doing. What I had not told you was that 1 in 4 physicians are diagnosed with infertility, almost double the rate of the general public. A survey of 700 female surgeons found that 42% of them had suffered a pregnancy loss. And that is twice the rate of the overall population. Because of the stress of residency program, many physicians delay their family planning until they are done with training. And that's typically around the age of 32 to 35. After that, those who do start a family during that time often get resentment from their colleagues. In reality, my choice to start a family and taking maternity leave meant that another colleague could not see his parents during summer because he had to cover my shifts. But amidst these early struggles, my colleagues extended their hands to help. Gia, have you had lunch? All right, give me your pager. Go pump. Because I had my support system with me, I started to embrace motherhood both at home and at work. I told my supervisors that I had to pump at certain times. They adjusted the rounding time to my schedule. No questions asked. I brought my child to dinner events unapologetically. Other residents, they were observing my motherhood journey, not to judge, but as a source of inspiration and courage. They felt like they too can become a parent while advancing their careers. This Twitter thread was viewed 3 million times, reshared 5,000 times, and had 24,000 likes. If I had just given some data about physician infertility, no one is going to be really compelled to share that Twitter thread. It was the story that shed light on the issues physicians were facing. At the same time, it was a story that showed how kindness and support was the first step in building a healthy culture as we welcome new parents in medicine. This one tweet led to a journal publication highlighting systemic issues in medical residency program and recommendations on how to redesign programs to improve physician well-being. Data does not create movements. Stories do. Now, data does not only happen on the outside. We have so much data within our head. We take snapshots of our experiences and observations, and then we store them into our heads as scenes. Sometimes, these are scenes that we are proud of. Other times, these are embarrassing and shameful moments that we want to shove into the pits of our memory. Whether we like it or not, we keep tabs of all the wins and losses throughout our lives. When I was 9, I went on stage to speak for the first time. After the first paragraph, the words stopped. At that moment, time slowed down as if I was running on 2G internet speed. Finally, I mumbled a thank you and ran off stage. I'm sure the people in the audience would not have remembered this story. But in my mind, I had this data stored. The number of times being frozen on stage, 1. And for most people, that is 1 time too many. As I grew, I had more data stored. The number of times I had a low score in high school exams and medical school exams, 15. The number of paper rejections, 22. The number of cringeworthy moments, 300. The number of times I came home late from work, 1,265. Based on this data, I could deduce that I'm a bad student, a mediocre researcher, an awkward person, and a terrible mother. But I could also tell a different story. The number of failures could mean that I'm brave, always willing to try something out of my comfort zone. The number of late nights could mean that I'm the type of parent who would do anything to secure my family's livelihood. Data storytelling isn't just for scientists or activists. The most important data story of all is the one we tell ourselves. depending on how we frame the story of data, it will lead us to different actions or different paths. Tell a pessimistic story, and we will retreat. Tell a story full of hope, and we will move forward. What outcome do we desire? Now, close your eyes and picture a scene in your life. What story have you created around it? If it's a story that harms you, say this now. I have the power to rewrite my story. Open your eyes. Data itself is not negative or positive. Data alone can't create change. It is the story we tell that moves us forward. What story will you tell? Thank you.